I did say all you had to say was he rides motorcycles, and that would be sufficient for the bio. But thank you for the nice words. So what I have up on the screen here, I didn't have a slide, so I thought I'd share it. We just released at Creative Commons a report we called the State of the Commons, and we're going to do this every year. And we seek to not only identify how many openly licensed works are in the world, and we, through a partnership with Google, just got updated data, and Google told us very, very conservatively there are 882 million Creative Commons licensed works in the world. And this is everything from music to movies to textbooks to you name it. Anything that can be copyrighted can be openly licensed. And when they said conservatively, what they meant is what Google can see are the machine-readable Creative Commons licenses, those that actually have the code in them when you go to our website and get the license. Most of the world doesn't use those. Most of the world just says this is under a Creative Commons license. So it's safe to say we're well over a billion licenses and climbing fast, but we'll continue to get better metrics on that. Another thing that's worth pointing out briefly, and I'll talk about what CC licenses are for those of you who don't know, is that there's been a real shift in the types of licenses that people are using. They're moving toward what we call the free culture licenses, the CC0, which puts works into the public domain, CC BY and BY SA. And that's a good thing, because in education, the fewer restrictions that are on the works, the more flexibility we have. I'll stop there, but I recommend you take a look at that. I think you'll enjoy the report. And with that, let me bring up this. Well, in the spirit of open educational resources and using other people's works, I've got a whole list, and in fact, most of these people are in the room, where I've remixed their slides for my presentation as an example, trying to lead by example here. So David Wiley, who's speaking tomorrow, Nicole Allen, there's Nicole. Dave, raise your hand. Dave from Minnesota, Dave Ernst. Where's Harris? David Harris, yeah. And Jerry from Merlot. So all these people have wonderful slide decks, and you'll see many of their slides in here. And all properly marked, I hope. If I haven't properly given attribution, they should slap me across the face, and I will do so. So we're going to talk about several things tonight. We'll certainly talk about open educational resources. We're going to talk about new policies that are emerging. We'll talk about the business case for open. Of course, all these slides are under a Creative Commons attribution license, and you may use them as you see fit. I always start by asking, why are we here? So there were some many excellent presentations, starting with our opening keynote this morning, talking about the way things are. There was an excellent economic analysis of the way the textbooks work and how they've changed over time. I attended several other presentations where people talking about what they do today in education and the challenges and barriers that they face to innovation and change. And that's all true. But I'm going to try to convince you tonight that our job as educators in the 21st century is to understand the new tools that we have in our toolbox that we didn't have even 15 years ago, and that as educators, it's our moral and ethical responsibility to use those tools to help more people get an education, the other 50%, as the Vice Chancellor said, get access not only to free resources or extremely low-cost resources vis-a-vis open educational resources, but also higher quality resources that provide greater academic freedom for faculty because they've got the legal rights to change them, et cetera. So I believe as educators that our goal should be very simple, that everyone on the planet should have access to all of the educational resources that they desire, and they should be able to access educational opportunities. And we believe this as educators because we understand that an education is a good thing. We understand it's good for individuals. It helps people have more complete, well-rounded lives, more interesting lives. We understand that an educated person is good for the communities that they live in, starting with their family. Educated people have significantly lower rates of domestic violence in the household, for example. There are also lower crime rates as people get higher levels of education. Societies generally, it doesn't matter what statistics you look at, are generally more peaceful as their population has a higher education. You know in higher education that people have higher salary levels over a lifetime. They make significantly more money. When there are recessions like the one that we just went through in 2008, we're coming out of just now quite strongly in the United States, people who have advanced degrees are significantly less likely to be unemployed during times of recession. I remember in 2008 when the stock market crashed, I sat down with my wife, who's a veterinarian, and I said, honey, this isn't going to affect us at all. Because I have a PhD, she has a DVM, there's a supply of jobs for professionals with advanced degrees that doesn't diminish even in the worst economic crises. If you were somebody with a high school diploma and that was your level of academic attainment in 2008, you were in real trouble. Even if you were somebody with just a bachelor's degree, you were in real trouble. Right. So we know this. Education's a good thing. So let me talk about some of the new tools that we have that we didn't have even 15 years ago. But these tools that we'll chat about have been around for roughly a decade. First and foremost is that what we use in education, what we've used for 10 years, is digital. So raise your hand if you remember going and using copying machines, right? To copy, some of you probably still do this. Do you remember, what were they called? The mimeograph machines and overheads and all that stuff. We don't use that anymore. How many of you are around when you use tape-to-tape reels for audio in your classrooms, right? So what we used to do was based in an analog world. We had analog audio, we had analog video, we had VHS tape and all that. We certainly had typewriters and other ways to have analog text. We don't do analog anymore. Everything we do is digital. I challenge you to go into any store, I think any store in the world, and good luck finding film for your old camera that shoots film, right? I don't even think you can buy it anymore. It's all digital. If you wanted to go buy an audio recorder today, it's all digital. They don't make anything that has tape in it anymore, unless it's digital videotape, right? Same thing is true of textbooks. Yes, we still print textbooks and we sell printed copies, but all of those files are digital, right? Every single file that OpenStax has, every single file that McGraw-Hill has that they use are digital files. So why do we care so much about digital? Well, digital things are different from an economic sense and a supply chain sense than things that are analog. Digital things can be stored, copied, and distributed for the marginal cost of zero. Now, let's be clear, there are other parts of supply chain that economists look at and say they're a very high cost. So we know that production costs still very high of digital things. In some cases, McGraw-Hill, are you still here? No, but OpenStax is. So OpenStax will tell you, hey, when you're building, McGraw-Hill's not here, they didn't want to come to this talk. But OpenStax will tell you that, hey, sometimes building in digital is significantly more expensive, right? It takes a lot, and maintenance of digital things, still very high cost. But once you've produced something that's digital and you're maintaining it, how much does it cost to make another 100 copies of that thing? Or 1,000 copies of it? Or 1,000,000 copies of it? And the answer is the marginal cost has fallen to zero. Now, why is that? Well, it's for a whole host of reasons. We've got this thing called the internet. So the transmission of bits has become almost zero cost. When things were made out of analog, you had to put them on airplanes and on trucks, and it was very, very expensive to move textbooks around the world, right? That's a high cost. Once it's digital, cost essentially falls to zero. Why else? Well, because we've got cloud computing, right? The cost of storage and disk space has fallen so low because of big services like Amazon's EC2 and Microsoft's Azure, and even what you do here on campus, the cost of disk space has fallen significantly faster than Moore's Law predicted that it would. So let's drive this home to the theme of the conference, textbooks. Here's what it costs, and these are David Wiley's slides, right? We're remixing here. This is what it costs to make a copy of a textbook. So you look at the different options we have in front of us. Can you copy by hand? Yes, believe it or not, you can still hire people to copy textbooks by hand. It's very expensive, I wouldn't recommend it. Right? Copy by print on demand? Sure, you can print it for about $5. You stick it up in Amazon's CreateSpace, and you can print out, if you're doing a run of 1,000 or so 250-page textbooks, you can bring the cost down under $5. And that'll even include the shipping and handling, it's a great deal. But how much by a computer? It's 0.00084 cents. Right? So how did David get these numbers? He took a 250-page open textbook and he uploaded it into Amazon, and it gave him the metrics on how much it was going to cost for each copy that was made. So how many students do you have here at UGA? 35,000. So somebody whip out their cell phone, which all have calculators on them, right? And multiply 35,000 by 0.00084. I mean, you have the number shouted out. Okay, here are the cost of distribution, right? So same thing. You can pay to ship them by mail if you want to. But the cost of distribution by, what's the number? Somebody have?
It's
Now, how many dollars would it be?
$34,000?
$28.50. So does anybody have $28 in their pocket? We just bought every student at the University of Georgia a new Stats 101 textbook. Congratulations. So cost of distribution, same thing. Almost zero. Not quite zero. So there's still costs involved in this. So here's the question. When copying, distribution, and storage essentially fall to zero cost, what do we as educators do with that information? That is a real tool. We've had that tool for a decade now, and we can do something with it. So to show you how out of whack we are with other industries, anybody subscribe to Spotify, the music service, right, or any of those? Or how about Netflix or Hulu or any of the TV shows you can, right? Well, so those cost about $10 a month, give or take. Some of them are a little bit less, some are a little bit more, but roughly 10 bucks a month. So this is an analysis David did, and then somebody else remixed it and put up this blog post. Great image. So for $20 a month, you can kind of have access to all of the music on the planet, literally 15 million songs on Spotify on your phone. Plus, you can have access to all of the television and movies that have come out of United States networks, cable television, and Hollywood for 20 bucks a month. Or you can lease one textbook from McGraw-Hill. Which industries have been properly disrupted by things being digital? Right? So this is how behind we are in being disrupted by digital technology. There's a lot of reasons for that. Okay, so let's dive into open educational resources, and let's be very specific about what we mean by that. So we talked about the tools that we have because of computers, the internet, things being digital. That's really important. Another tool that we have is open licensing. So this is also 10 years old. This is where I work. Creative Commons is a nonprofit organization. We provide the free open copyright licenses that the world uses to share stuff. So those initial metrics I was given about how we're closing in on a billion items, well, that's what people are using. They're saying, I've got this piece of music, I've got this drum beat, I'd like to share it and let others remix, build upon my work. I'm an academic researcher at UGA, and I want to publish in an open access research journal, and I would put my biology article into the Public Library of Science. It has a Creative Commons attribution license on it. I took some of that $2 billion from the US Department of Labor to build new academic programs. The government required me to put a CC BY license on it. I'm openly licensing it so the public has access to what they paid for. So we're 10 years old, we operate globally, and I'll show you what that looks like in a minute. Here's why we exist. Before Creative Commons, you had the public domain, and you had all rights reserved copyright. Librarians in the room, put your hands up. Librarians, how does something get into the public domain in the United States? What has to happen first? Dead people, right? So first you have to die, and then Meryl, how long does it take after you're dead? We don't want Meryl to die. 70 years if you're an individual. If you're a corporation, it's 95 years, right? So you got to remember the original purpose of copyright law in the U.S. Constitution was to give the creator, the author, a short period of monopoly over the work, a short copyright, so that they could benefit financially and make copies. And they had a set of rights, legal rights, protected by the U.S. federal government for a short period of time. That initial period was 14 years. You could reapply for a second 14 years. Only about 30% of U.S. citizens actually reapplied for the second term. That by the U.S. Congress and interests that wanted to influence the U.S. Congress, that has grown and continues to grow. And in fact, there are secret negotiations happening now in the between the United States and several other countries to extend that 70-year term to 90 years. So it'd be death plus 90 for something to get into the public domain. Okay, so that's how things get into the public domain. In other countries, it's even longer. It's death plus 100 if you're in Mexico. Okay, then you know, on the other end of the spectrum, you've got all rights reserved copyright. Nothing wrong with copyright. Authors should have their rights protected. If somebody builds something and they don't want to share, there's nothing wrong with that. That's okay, right? We should respect the author's right to make that choice. The problem was there was nothing in between, right? So when I was an assistant professor at Ohio State, I taught all these online courses. It was all digital. I knew that I could share for free with everybody on the planet, and I was happy to share my course materials. So I had some friends in Australia, and they said, Cable, we'd like to use your course. I said, great. Here's the website. Here's all the files. You can download it. Take it. And they said, we're not going to touch it with a 10-foot pole. Meryl, why wouldn't Australia take my course? What did it say at the bottom of the website? Had a little C with a circle around it. All rights reserved copyright, Ohio State University. And I said, but I'm not going to sue you. And they said, Cable, we're not worried about you. You're not the copyright holder. Ohio State University can sue us, right? And so the net result was no sharing happened. Now, the alternative when I was at Ohio State was I had to go get my own lawyer. I'm a graduate student. Do you think I could afford my own attorney? No, right? And so I marched over to the Attorney General's office at Ohio State, and I said, would you please write a custom license for me so that I can share my copyrighted work with Australia? And they laughed me out of the office. And this was happening all over the planet, to musicians, to artists, to photographers, to academic researchers, to educators who wanted to share using these new digital tools, using the internet, being able to share at the marginal cost of zero, but they couldn't do so legally. People wanted to keep their copyright and share under the terms and conditions that they chose. They wanted both. They didn't want to give up their copyright, they wanted to share. That's Creative Commons. Okay, so we say, look, keep your copyright. You should never give up your copyright. So Nicole works at Spark. Spark's got a great tool called the Author Addendum, which says, hey, UGA faculty, stop turning over your copyright to academic journals when they require you to do so for publication. Give them an author addendum that says, you may have non-exclusive copyright. I, the faculty at UGA, keep my non-exclusive copyright, and then I have rights to my article. Because what happens at UGA all the time is UGA faculty will get an NIH grant or an NSF, well, not NIH, an NSF grant or a Department of Education grant or a Department of Energy grant, and they will take that money, they will do great research, and they will publish in UGA's libraries because of budget cuts, had to cut journals. Meryl, you ever have to cut a journal in your library? Never, she says. I bet she has. And then what happens is the faculty who did the research took that federal money, our money that we paid for, public money, and Meryl had to cancel a journal because of budget cuts. She had no choice. Journals are very expensive. Now the faculty member at UGA who no longer holds copyright can't even use her own article in her own class, even though it's her research. Happens all the time. Okay? We said that's not okay. It's better to keep your copyright, share under the terms you want. These are the different terms you can choose from. All of our licenses require attribution. Share alike means if somebody takes your work and they change it, they modify it, they have to share their change under the same terms that you licensed your work under. That's Wikipedia. Wikipedia is attribution, share alike, everything in Wikipedia. Non-commercial says you can take my work, but you can't make primary commercial use of it. You can't sell it. So if I'm sharing my textbook and it has a non-commercial license on it, you can't stick it up on the web and charge $19.95 for it. That would be a violation of non-commercial. By the way, it is not a violation of non-commercial for your faculty to take something that has an NC license on it and use it as curriculum in your classroom. That's okay. What's not okay is to tell your students you have to pay any amount of money to get access to that curriculum. It's okay to charge tuition, so you should be using other people's NC content in your courses. No derivatives flat out violates OER definition, so my recommendation is stay away from it because no derivatives means you can't change it. So faculty in your room, put your hands up. So faculty, what are the odds that you're going to take somebody else's work, even if it's free and has an open license on it, and use it exactly as it is and make absolutely no changes? What do you want to do as faculty? Modify it, tweak it, change it, move the order around, throw away the parts you don't want, write in new parts, remix some of this with some of that, right? Put in some of your own materials. You deserve that kind of flexibility. Frankly, that's part of your academic freedom, is your right to remix into your learning environment what you need. And so no derivative works have their purpose, and that's why we have the option and the license, but we really don't recommend it for educational uses. So when you mix and match these different conditions, what you get are one of six of our different open copyright licenses. And when you lay them out, and I stole this from Nicole because it was her good idea. When you lay this out, I think you took it from me and then you made it better. Now I'm taking it back. See how this works? So when I say most free to least free, it's not cost. There's no cost to use any of these licenses. They're all zero cost dollars to use. Doesn't cost anything. I mean degrees of freedom. How many degrees of freedom, how much flexibility are you giving to other people when you put a license on your work? So OpenStax, David, put your hand up. So OpenStax licenses their textbooks under the CC BY license. What that means is legally, if you use an OpenStax textbook, you must legally give OpenStax attribution in the way that they've asked to receive attribution. You don't have a choice. They're backed by the full force of US copyright law. If you do not give them attribution, you could be sued under the Copyright Act and you would lose. Now, of course, giving attribution is easy, and you should do it anyway because we don't plagiarize in the Academy, but it's super, super easy, right? You get down into these more restrictive licenses, and I have now reduced how much freedom I'm giving you, the downstream user, from my work. So bottom line on this is that if you want other people to use your stuff, try to be up at the top of this chart and not down at the bottom. Now, at the very top, you see we've got something called, it's a zero, right? We call this CC0. This actually isn't a license. This is a protocol where you can put your work into the public domain today. So Merrill doesn't want to have to die first and then 70 years go by, and we all remember how nice Merrill was, before her work goes in the public domain. She might want to dedicate something to the public domain today, and she can use CC0 to do that. When I say we're a global organization, we've got teams in 75 countries around the world. Our headquarters staff is mostly in the United States and in Canada. Does anybody use Creative Commons? Yeah, a lot of people do. Here are a few of the projects. Everything Wikipedia. If you go to Flickr, I think they're up to 305 million images in Flickr now. So faculty at UGA, please stop going to the web and Google Images and just grabbing images for your slide decks. Eventually, that will bring you into copyright infringement, putting you at legal risk and UGA. Assistant Chancellor, cover your ears on that one, right? Very, very dangerous, right? It can be upwards of $20,000 per copyright infringement. You don't want that kind of hassle. And so instead, what you should do is go to something like Flickr or other platforms and filter your searches by CC license. And then you know you've got the legal rights to use it in perpetuity. Nobody will ever sue you. You can use it. You need to give proper attribution. You need to follow the license. CERN, any physicists in the room? No physicists in the room? Everybody know what CERN is? Super Collider, right? They're smashing atoms together, figuring out how the universe works. These guys have a lot of smart people that work at CERN, some brilliant physicists, some really amazing scientists, but they know that they don't have all of the amazing scientists in the world. They know that some of them are here in Athens. Some of them are in other parts of Georgia. Some of them are in other parts of the world. And so what they're doing is they're dumping their data out on their website, and they're putting out videos, and they're putting out their pre-publication prints, their white papers about what they think they're finding in the dark matter experiments they're doing under Creative Commons licenses, so that other people around the world can help solve the challenges of the universe quicker than they can with just their own folks that they have. So think about that. So use that example and think about your own fields, right? So I used to teach in education psychology, and there's no possible way that I can read all of the ed psych articles that are coming out. There's no way I can be up to date on all the best practices. But if I'm sharing my work under an open license, and if I've got my eyes open and I'm looking around at what other people are willing to share with me, then odds are I'm going to be able to put together a better ed psych class, a better educational experience for my students, than if I'm just relying on myself. Right? That's the statement that CERN is making. Musicians around the world, we don't have time to go into this, this is a whole other presentation. Amazing work happening where musicians are sharing their work under CC license. Journalism and broadcast news, it's huge in there. Publishing, including some for-profit publishers, use Creative Commons licenses. Don't worry, OpenStax, I know you're not on this list, but I have a whole slide for you later. Museums, galleries, archives, libraries are using Creative Commons licenses. Libraries in particular and museums have been really great at saying, we've got these huge collections. So actually this place we're in today is a great example. There are collections here that I won't have time to see, and unless they're up online and there's high-res digital images, then I probably will never see them. And better yet, if I'm teaching something that I want to use, if everything's all rights reserved copyright, it's actually against the law for me to use those images I take off the website, unless I'm linking to you. So what I'd really like to do is have everything in this museum under high-res and 3D scanners around all of the sculptures and put all those things up under Creative Commons licenses, because then I can use them in my classroom in Olympia, Washington, when I'm teaching at the community college next to my house. Okay, Europeana is a massive project in Europe that's doing just that. They're taking the archives of museums, they're taking all of the metadata, they're putting the data under CC0 so that other people who don't work for the museums can build new apps for phones to help drive more traffic to their museums. And in a lot of cases, these are business decisions people are making. But we're in higher education. And we'll talk about a lot of examples in higher ed. There are literally hundreds of universities around the world that have followed MIT's lead You probably know a decade ago, MIT OpenCourseWare opened up their entire course catalog. All 2,100 courses at MIT are under a Creative Commons license. MIT said, here, take it. Jerry, how long has Merlot been running?
17 years.
So Merlot predates them by 7 years, a lot. And for 17 years, people around the world have been contributing to Merlot, a huge open repository, and they've been saying, here, I'm willing to share under an open license my works. Please take it. Others rate it, review it, make use of it. This is also happening in K-12 in primary schools around the world. Here are a few examples in the United States, but my favorite example is in Poland. So in Poland, up until recently, parents had to buy the textbooks for their children. And the net result of that 40-year policy is that half of the public school kids in Poland don't have textbooks. Why is that? Well, like here, textbooks are really expensive. And if you're a parent, maybe your job is to be a janitor at the local university, and you don't make a lot of money, and you've got two choices because textbooks cost about the same for your second grade student as the cost of the rent on your apartment for a year, what are you going to do? Put a roof over your kid's head or buy them second grade textbooks? Right? You put a roof over your kid's head and you feed them. That's the first priority. And so these parents would say to their children, please make friends with other children that have textbooks. Those are your friends. Right? Invite children home to play that have textbooks so you can learn. That was the state of affairs in Poland. We have a team in Warsaw, and our team said, that's not okay. And they went to the president and said, Mr. President, this is not the country that we want to have. Did you realize? President said, well, but that's the state of affairs. So some of the presentations we heard talked about how it's awful, but that's the way things are. Part of my message to you tonight is we get to remake those rules. So in Poland, what they said was, gosh, how much would it cost to solve this problem, given that we've got Creative Commons licensing, things can be digital, we can store, distribute, make copies at the marginal cost of zero. And for $14 million a year, which even in Poland is a rounding error on the national budget, for that small amount of money, they put out a whole e-project. It's kind of like the big Department of Education project that's going on in K-12 now, where it's bandwidth, devices, professional development for teachers, and content. And they started with two open textbooks. They have a CC BY license on them. And now for at least those two subjects, all the kids in Poland have books. And it was so successful, now they're ramping that up and they're gonna build out the rest of the books. Right? This is not difficult. It's also not expensive. It's not expensive to build them. It's not expensive to maintain them as compared to the economics of what we're doing now. And I'll show you some specifics in just a moment. So open educational resources, we've been throwing this term around. What do we actually mean by OER? Well, this is the Hewlett definition, which most of the world uses. It's everything you use in your classroom, teaching, learning, research materials. And then there's two conditions that make it OER or don't make it OER. The first condition is a legal condition. So either the work is in the public domain or it has an open license on it that allows you to repurpose the work to meet your needs. Okay. The second condition is it's free. It's no cost. If it meets those two conditions, it's OER. So thinking about it like this is easier. It's free, plus you've got the legal rights to do these five things. And this comes from David Wiley. You can reuse it, so I can take it exactly as it is and just use it. I can revise it. I can change it to meet my needs. I can remix it. I can take some of that MIT OpenCourseWare and that Wikipedia article and that open textbook I found at the University of Minnesota's open textbook catalog and create something new. I can redistribute it. I can share that new remix with everybody else in the state of Georgia, and I can retain it. I can keep a copy. So part of what you heard come out of the discussion with McGraw-Hill earlier today and some of the questions is that the new model of publishers, because of course commercial publishers also understand the affordances of digital things. They know they can store, copy, and distribute their works for near zero cost as well, and that's a good thing. They should. They want to leverage that, but they understand that creates a marketplace of abundance. They don't want a marketplace of abundance. They want a marketplace of scarcity because scarce resources cost lots of money. And so how do you create scarcity in a world of abundance? You put artificial barriers on those flows of abundance. How do you do that technically? It's called digital rights management or technical protection measures. You put digital locks on digital works so that only the person that paid for that short-term license has access to it. That's problem number one. Problem number two is that it has a time bomb on it. So after the amount of period of time that you've paid for access to the resource, your access goes away. That's not okay. All right, and I take this point very, very seriously. As educators, we should be absolutely offended and appalled to your core that in a world of abundance where we can store, distribute, and make copies for the marginal cost of zero, that we would actually intentionally take away a learning resource from a student because we're trying to maintain existing business models. That's not okay. This is a slide that Nicole put together, which I love, so I had to put it in. Anybody seen this movie? Right? Men in Black? What's that thing that they're holding? What's that called? Yeah. Usually when I ask people, like, that's the flashy thingy. It's the neuralizer. That's right. What does the neuralizer do? It makes you forget, right? It takes away your memory. So Nicole made this and says, are you done reading? Good, because you lose access to your resources. Right? Think how stupid that is, right? If I'm going in and I'm going to learn calculus, is it just possible I might need my advanced algebra books? Right? My wife is a veterinarian. She was taking organic chemistry, which was a really hard course for her. Right? She actually had to go back, go to the bookstore, and find used chemistry books because she needed her basic 101, 102, and 103 chem books to figure out OChem. Right? But all those books were gone. She didn't have access to them. It is crazy to think in this world that we are not facilitating our learners developing a library of resources that they get to keep as they're going through our learning institutions. That goes for K-12 as well. Okay, so some other benefits of OER. Well, there's things you can do with OER because you've got the legal rights to change them any way you want to meet your needs. You can translate them. At UGA, do you have any students where English is not their first language? Probably a lot, right? In my state, in Washington State, English is number one, Spanish is number two, followed closely by Vietnamese, Chinese, right? Those are our languages. And so our schools, the community colleges where I used to work, are looking at, yeah, we got everything in English. Now our next step is, how much of this can we get in Spanish, right? So they're actually thinking about OER as a way to serve first-generation students that are coming in who are having trouble succeeding. It's the other 50%, right? It's another way you can help them. Accessibility, right? You're all subject to 508 guidelines. Faculty, put your hands up again. Keep your hands up if your course has gone through a rigorous 508 ADA compliance review and you're absolutely compliant with all federal laws. Oh, wait, all the hands are down, right? So one of the nice things about OER is that there are organizations, nonprofits like Benetech and Flow and CAST out of Harvard. That's all they do is their job is to help make the world more accessible. And there's huge federal grant funds available for that kind of work. And they actually take OER regularly and update it, make it better, make it more accessible. I know OpenStax is particularly good at this. But here's what really should matter, I think, most to faculty. Customization and affordability. I know that we haven't always thought, and our first speaker today, who I see him back there, great talk, by the way, he talked about the inelastic demand, I think, of textbooks, right? The students are the consumer, but they don't get to choose the book. The faculty choose the book. And so affordability is a big problem. Right? Your students, raise your faculty, your students ever complain about the high cost of textbooks in your class? Right? Well, what you probably didn't know is 60 to 70% of them are not buying the book. So we've got survey data that Nicole worked on, we'll show in just a minute. But faculty should mostly be concerned about this. If you as faculty are working with educational materials, with content, in the 21st century with this toolbox we've got, and you don't have the legal rights to customize it to meet your exact needs for your class, for your university, for your college, for your students, then I've got to tell you, you're working with the wrong stuff, right? If you are taking something from a publisher and you can't change it, that's not good. That's violating your academic freedom. You need to be able to change it. How do faculty remix today? Faculty remix like my faculty remix when I was a doctoral student at Ohio State. They assigned me 7 books and they said, Cable, read chapter 1 out of that one, read these pages out of that one, read this out of that one. That was how they remixed. Is that an efficient way to remix? No, because that class cost me $200 in textbooks. So let's dive into textbooks a little bit. I think this is a Nicole slide. Yeah. No, US PIRGS, when Nicole was their last job. Here's what's happened to textbooks, right? You saw some of these stats earlier. It's gone up 800% in the last 30 years. 65% of students are opted not to buy a textbook, at least one of their required textbooks in their courses, because of cost, right? Average cost of textbooks and materials up to $1,200. Why? Well, our first speaker talked about this. This is the cycle of decision making, right? The professor decides which book to buy. The students have to buy what's chosen if you want to be a full participant in the class, right? And so as faculty, is it okay that 3/4 of your students, a little less than 3/4, are walking in with less than all of the instructional materials that you've designed for your class? I would say no, right? Are they going to be more successful if they have all of the educational resources that you've designed for them to be successful, right? Of course they will. So, I mean, you should look at OpenStax. You should look at other OER projects that are out there where people are sharing. This was a study out of Florida that Nicole and others worked on that shows some of this. And it's not just that 60% in Florida, and then we had 70%, I think, were the numbers that came out of the California study, but 50% fewer students took fewer, I'm sorry, 50% of students took fewer courses due to the textbook costs. So your second 50%, you have problems with them. You said getting across the finish line. I'm assuming you mean graduating, right? If they're taking fewer classes, is that going to reduce the chance they graduate? Of course it is, right? Or at a minimum, worst case, best case scenario, it's going to increase their time to degree. And so one of the things that I do when I sit down with college administration and with deans and provosts is we look at all of the key performance indicators that they're tracking. What are the metrics that they care about? So they're trying to reduce time to degree. They're trying to decrease student debt. They're trying to increase how much of the financial aid package can go to cover the total need of the students, right? Well, OER and open textbooks in particular can actually improve all of those metrics. So administrators in the room, that should be your task number one, is to look at all your KPIs that you've got and ask yourself, where can open be helpful? But look at some of these numbers. 23% regularly go without textbooks at all due to cost. 14% are dropping out. David will talk tomorrow morning in his talk. I can say this because he's not here, so I'm going to steal some of his slides. Oh, no, he came.
Dr. Green.
Ah, so David tomorrow. Well, he's late. I'm going to use one of your slides. So David will talk about some research that he did recently where when OER goes into a course and replaces the commercial content, the college actually makes more tuition money, which I guarantee is a key performance indicator that your administration cares about, right? It's dollars in, and the reason, there are several reasons, but one of the main reasons is that they don't drop out during the add drop period. Because they stay in the class, they don't drop out, they actually pay full tuition. That's money that the university recoups that they wouldn't have otherwise had. I'll let David give the specifics because it's a really great story. So this is a message for faculty, taking straight from Nicole here. How are your students supposed to learn with materials that they can't afford and are not even buying? Right? How can you expect them to be successful in your class? So Dave, put your hand up. So this is a guy that you want to have come to your institutions. David's done a really fabulous job at the University of Minnesota putting together an open textbook catalog of all of the best open textbooks across a variety of fields that are taught at University of Minnesota, which of course are exactly the same fields and courses that you teach at UGA and everywhere else. And even better, his faculty said, you know, one of the things we want is reviews on these textbooks. We want reviews from our peers. And so he's got a whole program. If you haven't talked with Dave about this, you should. He's got amazing success rates where when people go through a 2-hour session with David and his team, what do you get for conversion rates to open textbooks? 35%. So after 2 hours of their presentations, 35% of those people move to open textbooks. You still have Hewlett money to fly around to people's a little bit. Call David, get him to come to your campus. Okay, I put this up. This is David Wiley's company, Lumen. There are new interesting business models, so back to the economics discussion, that are actually sprouting up around OER in the same way that we saw lots and lots of businesses sprouting up around open source software. So you've all heard of Linux operating systems, right? Linux is free, it's open source, you don't have to pay for Linux. But most of the world pays a little bit of money to this company called Red Hat, because Red Hat does quality assurance, there's an 800 number you can call, implementation services, they do hosting, and it's really, really cheap. And you get this great service, and you get the open source software, which frankly is better than the commercial server options. It's got fewer security holes in it, et cetera. Well, David's company, and the reason I have this slide at all is that everything that they build with their clients, it, as a matter of a contractual obligation between David's company, Lumen, and the university or the college, everything they build together in that relationship gets put under a Creative Commons attribution license. So it's really interesting from the perspective of the college or university. They wanted to do OER anyway, so it's a great license to have on it. They now have OER. From a business perspective, though, it's also very interesting because David and his team can go in to one university and build a whole new academic program, say in biology, maybe build a couple new open textbooks, things that didn't exist in the commons before, and now everybody else can have access to it immediately. But when they go to the next college and the next college says, gosh, we'd really love to have a biology program that's all OER, David and his team would say, funny you ask that. You know, we've actually already built it, and the rights are not tied up with College A. The rights are in the commons. Everybody can use it, and so we can use it over here at College B as well. So a way of completely rethinking how businesses are run and how intellectual property, instead of hoarding it and not sharing as a competitive advantage, making sharing the competitive advantage. Another great example, Tidewater Community College. This is one of the schools that Lumen worked with. Took an entire degree program and took all of the textbook costs out of it. And they call this the Z degree. And the textbooks used to cost $3,700 in the degree. Now they cost zero. Right? And it's this can be done. So I'm going to shift here a bit to policy. So governments have started to perk up and pay attention to this. University governments, administration, boards of trustees, state governments, provincial governments, national governments, and international governmental organizations. So governments at all levels have started to say, huh, this seems like there's a different way we should be thinking about flows of money. We should be thinking about policies in new ways. We should think about how to provide incentive structures for people to act and behave in new ways and to take advantage of these tools, digital, internet, CC licensing, et cetera. So California a few years ago took $5 million of public funds right out of the state coffers and said, go build open textbooks. Now, unfortunately, the publishers got in there and got a restriction put on where that money has to be matched by outside sources. So only a million of that's been released so far because Gates and Hewlett came in and dumped $500,000 apiece. But because they went in and lobbied against it. Did the publishers want $5 million of new open textbooks on the market? Absolutely not. Right? Are we going to do it anyway? Yes. And British Columbia saw that and said, that's a really good idea. We should do that too. So they opened with a couple million, and now Saskatchewan and Alberta have signed an MOU with British Columbia, and they now have this whole multi-province thing going on, and they're looking at building additional textbooks, and they're sharing with each other. David, Nicole, and several of us, OpenStax, we convened a meeting because we said, well, hold on, everybody. California, before you go build new open textbooks, and British Columbia, before you go build new open textbooks. That's great that you want to, and it's great that you've got public money to do so, but time out. First, let's see what's already out there. So OpenStax came and said, here's what we've already got. If you want to revise them and make them better and sink money into that, great, let's do that, but let's not recreate the wheel. Maybe we need two or three versions of Intro to Psych, but we certainly don't need 15 or 20 versions of Intro to Psych. Right, let's revise and remix and improve. And then we flew in the team from Sea of Lua from South Africa, and they said, here's what we've already got. And by the time we laid everything out, we had over 100 open textbooks that California and British Columbia had looked at and thought about. And David Ernst said, well, gosh, you know, we've already got this catalog at Minnesota. And so we all agreed as this big group, and it's not only this state and province and more provinces, but now it's Washington and Utah comes and Idaho and California and Oregon. And we all said, look, when we build new stuff, we all collectively agree we'll put it under a CC BY license and we'll tell everybody else that we built it. And that way, collectively, we all put in a little, but we all get a lot back. Right? So it's just a new way of thinking about the economics and the sharing. My last job was in the Washington Community Colleges. And we started, we didn't have the other 50%. Your other 50% was our 100%, right? All of our students were needy. All of our students, for the most part, very, very poor is probably the wrong word, but they were poor. They didn't have discretionary income to weather even the smallest of bumps in their lives. If the alternator in their car died, that was enough to kick them out of college because they didn't have enough money to buy textbooks for that class, and so I'm not even gonna attend because I know I'm not gonna be successful. That's how much discretionary income these folks have. And so we started having these conversations in the Washington Community Colleges. We said, you know, if we've got faculty in our classrooms that are saying, I'm the only faculty member who can build Stats 101 content, and if it wasn't invented here, it's garbage, we have to get rid of that attitude. We have to move to proudly borrowed from there, which means that if somebody at UGA built a really great Intro to Stats textbooks. And if OpenStax has it, which they do have an Intro to Stats CC BY textbook that I can take for free, at a minimum, my responsibility is to review those resources and ask myself if I can revise them and make them better to make my students have, or get my students access to high quality free educational resources. And if we're not doing that, we're not doing our jobs well. So we had that conversation first. Second, we said, content is absolutely necessary. So earlier, David and I were running a session, and David said, content is infrastructure. And he's absolutely right. You've got to have content in an education setting. Call it a textbook, call it a course pack, call it links to the web. Somewhere, somehow, you're going to have people reading something, watching some kind of videos. Right? You've got to have content. But it's not a strategic advantage. Meaning, people don't come to UGA for the Biology 101 textbook that you choose. I guarantee it. They don't come to UGA because of a particular syllabus that you have for Stats 101. They just don't. They come here for your great faculty. They come here for your beautiful campus. They come here because their parents came here. They come here because you've got high graduation rates and good job placement services. They come for all sorts of reasons, but not because of the content you're using in your class. And by the way, you use the same content that Minnesota does, that Rice University does, that everybody else. A lot of the same textbooks and a lot of the same syllabi. We've done these analyses. If you want to see them, I'm happy to share it. Okay? And we said, look, we just can't afford this. And here's what we mean. We ran, and I recommend you do this at all your Georgia institutions as well. Do a data run. Have your registrar's office pull the 100 or 200 highest enrolled courses and get the enrollments in each one of those courses. And then walk over to the bookstore and find out how much in each one of those courses are we spending in textbook costs. And if there's a rental program, factor that in if you can. If there's an open textbook, factor that in. You will be shocked at how high the numbers are. We were shocked. This was our highest enrolled course. We had 60,000 students. The system is 500,000 students, 34 colleges. 60,000 of them were taking English Composition 1. Basic writing class, $10.5 million a year. That's how much are our students. That's one state, one system. This isn't even the seven universities in the state of Washington, just the community colleges. And people said, that's awful, it's terrible, but what do we do about it? So the next thing we did is we said, where does that money come from? So we got with the financial aid directors and we traced it down. And the answer was a third, a third, a third. First third comes right out of the state coffers. It's state need grants, it's our state financial aid for the neediest students, which is most of the community college population. So a third of that money, $3.2 million or so, right out of the state funds. Legislature was not happy to hear that. Okay, we told them. The second third comes right out of federal grants, Pell grants mostly, but also subsidized Stafford loans. The final third, right out of students' pockets. That's either cash that they earned in jobs, probably classes they weren't taking, or their parents were helping. More often than not, when we surveyed students, it was debt. It was debt that they were taking on the back end of their degree. Okay? So we determined that this was, it's commonly referred to as insane behavior, right? Because we learned about OER and we said, this is not okay. And so we decided to do something about it. So we built what's called the Open Course Library. So if you go to opencourselibrary.org, you'll find this. It's the highest enrolled 81 courses. I know that's an odd number. We ran out of money at 81. But we built the highest enrolled 81 courses in the system. And they're all up there, and everything we built is under a CC BY license. But before we built anything, we took from other places. Right? So OpenStax was just getting started at the time. Now our faculty, I can't say our faculty, I don't work there anymore, but the faculty in Washington are actually going back and looking at OpenStax books and going, wow, these are really great. We think we're going to start to shoehorn some of these into the classes. We also took stuff from MIT and the Open University in England and from the chemistry department at UC Irvine. We took stuff from all over the world because we said, why would we waste our time recreating the wheel? We're going to remix like crazy. And then we're going to identify where the gaps are, and where there are gaps, that's where we'll build, right? But we're not going to build what's already been built that's good stuff that we deem to be high quality. Okay, K-12's worse. So I guarantee if I did an analysis of Georgia K-12, you'd have all the same problems. Your numbers would just be a lot bigger than ours are because we're a pretty small population state. These are the numbers in my state. I get particularly miffed at this slide, and I get a little angry sometimes, so forgive me, because I have two children who are 9 and 7 years old in the public school system. We got 1 million kids, mine are two of them. This is the garbage they have to put up. So my state spends $130 million a year on textbooks for K-12 for these 1 million school kids. That money comes 50-50 right out of the state coffers, $65 million. The other $65 comes out of property taxes that the individual districts, we have 294 districts in the state, they buy textbooks. Okay, so I want you to think about an Excel sheet. 12 grades, right, 12 rows, and then I want you to think about 8 subjects per grade, which is about what K-12 has. And so I want you to think, 8, you got about 96 cells, let's just call it 100 to have a nice even number, okay? You would think, I would think, that for $130 million a year, I could refresh all of those cells every single year. So one cell is 6th grade biology, another cell is 8th grade algebra, another cell is 2nd grade math, right? How many of those cells can we actually replace in any one school district? It varies, but it varies between about 3 to 7 cells. The other 93 cells go unupdated, not just for 1 year, but on average 7 to 10 years, because that's how long it takes to get through a refresh cycle based on the business models we're using, which is buy a really expensive textbook and amortize the cost of the book over a decade so that the textbook gets cheap. Okay, that made sense in an analog world. Does it make sense in a digital world? Does it make sense in a world with OER? So I sat down with our legislature and I said, well, first, let me get a little angry before I tell you what the legislature said. So it's worse than that. So A, let's get really angry at bullet number one here. Right? Is it okay, you know, the world that we live in, when all of you have supercomputers in your pockets, that we can look up anything on the planet, that you're handing students political science textbooks with copyright dates of 1998 on them? Because that's what's happened in the Seattle Public School District this year. Their poli-sci books have 1998 copyright dates. Has anything happened in political science since 1998? Right? Geography books, right? The copyright date is in mid-2000s, right? I don't know, little things like the Crimean Peninsula has changed boundaries slightly. You know, we don't have to wait for updates, right? If you put an open license on that stuff, you give the kids the updates. Not only that, but it's paper only, right? So my kids, even though they're lucky enough to have an iPad and a Kindle in the home and they got smartphones, my kids, none of their educational resources are on their digital devices. There is no digital anything. Okay, so that's a problem. Students, even though they go to the library, the librarians say, here's all the study skills, here's how you take notes, here's how you highlight, are they allowed to do any of that in their books? No, why not? You gotta keep the damn things for 10 years, right? Don't touch your books, don't personalize it. Everything else in our digital lives, we personalize like crazy, but not our textbooks. Gotta keep them for a decade, right? Students can't keep the books at the end of the year. My son just finished 2nd grade. I said, Nathan, thank you for finishing 2nd grade. Give us all of your learning resources back. You can't possibly need any of this in 3rd grade. Good luck in 3rd grade. That's what we tell our kids. Okay? All rights reserved. I sit down with the teachers at parent-teacher conferences, and I say, are you happy with all the educational resources you have? Is there anything you'd like to change? Do you have any outdated materials? And they laugh, and they say, there's a lot I'd like to change. It's all rights reserved copyright. I can't change any of it. And even if I had permission, it's all paper. How am I going to update it? It'd be really great if there were Creative Commons licenses with digital, I'd be good. I'd do it, I'd put the time in, right? And then this one, in my district, and this is true of most districts in Washington, when the kids start the school year, come home with a form for each book they've got. And the parents have to sign a form that says, if my students lose this book, they have to pay the school district $150 per book, because the school district has to go buy a new one, right? That's how much they cost for a replacement copy, $150. So I'm trying to be a good parent, teach my kids the value of money, teach them how to save, give to charity, et cetera. So I tell my kids, please don't lose your textbooks. They cost $150 to replace. And you lose everything. You lose your coats, you lose your hats, you never come home, you come home with one shoe sometimes. That's okay, but just try not to lose the textbooks, right? So you know what the net message my kids' takeaway was? They're afraid to take their books from home to school and back because they know they lose stuff. And so I say, you know what? You've got to have your learning resources. I put them in their backpacks, and my kids cry. And they say, Dad, please don't force us to take our textbooks to school. This is the system we've created. Okay? It's the same. You have this in Georgia in K-12 as well. Okay? Should we be angry about this as educators? Faculty in the universities, you want students to be prepared when they come out of K-12? This is the educational resources that they're dealing with. This is the system we're dealing with. Okay. And here's a little effort David and several of us started where we said, no, that is not okay. It's absolutely not okay. And so we started something called the K-12 OER Collaborative. And it's a collaborative because right now we've got 11 states who have come together and they've said, we would like to have all 100 cells digital, openly licensed, and we'd like to have them for free. And we, the state, we'd like somebody else to pay for the first initial spend, and that's not going to be cheap. That's going to be probably a couple $100 million by the time you're done. But my state alone is spending $130 million a year, and you saw the results we're getting. We think we can do K-12, all of it, for a couple $100 million. We're starting with Common Core. Georgia, are you Common Core state? Yes? Maybe, she says. I always have to ask. So Georgia, you should join. If you've got contacts in K-12, please have them email me. We want to talk to your State Department of Education. We have 11 other states right now who've joined forces, and we are building first math and English language arts. Why? Because the 44 U.S. states, Georgia included, and the three U.S. territories, and Washington, D.C., are on track to spend $8.2 billion updating just those two subjects. So of the 100 cells, those are 24 of the cells. $8.2 billion. We think we can do it for about $30 million and build everything and put a CC BY license on it. The states will hold the copyright, and the states will pick up the ongoing expenses. Right now, we're fundraising from the foundations for the $30 million. So is Gates and Hewlett going to continue to fund this thing forever? Absolutely not. But Gates and Hewlett and Arnold and a whole bunch of others are looking at the existing market. They're looking at this. They're saying, this is unacceptable. And as foundations, if we can come in and be a catalytic change to get to this, then we'll do that. We'll pay the upfront cost. And then states, you pick up the ongoing expenses. And so in Washington, my state looked at it and said, this is a no-brainer. You say we could have up-to-date curriculum in math and English language arts every year, and the kids could have digital content, and the teachers have it under a CC BY license, so each of our districts can tweak it as they see fit. And our end is like, what, a $250,000 a year, maybe $500,000 a year to help update these? We got to do this. We're in. And so did 10 other states, right? We're recruiting. Help us get Georgia. Okay? The website address, k12oercollaborative.org. Let's talk just real briefly about open policy. I know we're short on time. So open policy in a nutshell is this, that publicly funded resources ought be openly licensed resources. So David Wiley in the back, who's checking his cell phone, I see you back there, likes to say, if you walk into a pizza joint and you order a pizza and you pay for the pizza, you'd expect to get the pizza. And if they came back a second time and said, yeah, we know you already paid the bill, but we'd like you to pay the bill again and again and again, you'd be a little upset. And you probably wouldn't go back to that restaurant again. And yet that's exactly what we do. So here's our model. UGA, your faculty who take national government grants from federal agencies, here's how the model works today for academic research. Governments give big grants. Your faculty do the research at UGA. That's a good thing. We got to cure cancer. Articles get written and submitted. Peer review happens. That's good too. Copyright gets handed over to the journals. You have to give up all your intellectual property. Your copyright is gone. UGA doesn't own it, your faculty don't own it. It goes probably to Elsevier, which is a company in the Netherlands. Nothing against the Dutch, we love the Dutch. But it's now offshores. And then Merrill, how do you get that back? And Merrill's got to pay for it. Merrill doesn't have to pay for it once in the system. She probably has to pay for it for every single university. And the community colleges, put your hands up. The community colleges have to pay for it at each of the community colleges. And the seven universities in my state each have to pay for it. I mean, good grief, how many times do we, the U.S. public, who paid for the research to be done, have to pay back for the research? But it's even worse than that. So you have to pay for it back, and the public doesn't have any reuse rights. So we've got all these great technologies now where we can data mine, and we can do analyses of 100,000 articles and data sets simultaneously, and run interesting regression algorithms to see which types of cancer treatment actually worked and which ones didn't. Can't do any of that because the public doesn't have research rights. It's all held in copyright by the publishers. So what do you get? Slow scientific progress, and you get a lot of people that didn't even read it. A big Chronicle article came out a few months ago that said the average number of reads on the academic articles that you're all writing and submitting to for-profit closed journals, less than 3. Faculty, did you want to be read when you did all that research? Yes. You're not being read. Less than 3 is the average. Do you know what the average is for open access journals? More than that. It's 15 times the amount of reads, so it's on average 45. So if part of your intention of publishing was spreading knowledge to the world, which is kind of why we do research, right? We're sharing, we're pushing our fields forward, we're creating new knowledge. Okay, so here's what the model looks like under an open policy.
If you look, it's basically the same model with one minor change. The funder in the upper left corner simply says, if you take this money, you will openly license what you build with public money. So NIH has had a policy on the books for several years now, 5 years, I think, where they've said, if you take NIH money, within 12 months of publication, you must put a free, not an open copy, a free copy in our PubMed Central repository for the public to get access to. That's good. It's not good enough. We actually need a full open copy, like what the Public Library of Science does, but it's a good start. A better example is the U.S. Department of Labor. U.S. Department of Labor put out a $2 billion grant. That's billion with a B, so now we're talking about real money. They put out $2 billion to U.S. community colleges, universities, and their business partners to build new academic content to help put Americans back to work who lost jobs due to the economic crisis and to overseas outsourcing. So there are areas, the Department of Labor knows where these areas are, that's the business they're in, where there's job growth. There's job growth in advanced manufacturing, green technologies, IT, allied health. Raise your hand if you're retiring in 10 years or less. There you go, there's your allied health population right there. Right, so we need a lot more nurses and other people. Okay. And they said, if you take this money as a condition, a requirement on the grant, you will put a Creative Commons attribution license on what you build. If you don't like those terms, don't take the money. Nobody's forcing you to take this money. This is an optional, discretionary grant. So Associate Chancellor sitting in front of me here, whatever innovation money you have in the UGA system, you should put a CC BY license requirement, and you should do this. You should follow California Chancellor's office, system office lead. And what they did was on their $120 million a year of discretionary optional grants, they put a CC BY license requirement on. Because the old model in California system was that the Chancellor's office would give a grant to a community college, and that community college would build something, and then they wouldn't share it with anybody else because they didn't have to. The new model is the Chancellor's office says you have to put a CC BY license on it or you can't have the money. And now everybody in California, including where Jerry works at the Cal State system, can also take it. And that's a good thing because California taxpayers paid for all that money. Okay. Other examples, but we're running short on time. Let me end with just a couple of quick ones. First, on open policy, open organizations around the world, including Creative Commons and Spark and Lumen and Merlot, have you joined yet? Jerry, you gotta sign up. So we're recruiting.
Hallelujah!
Hallelujah, Jerry! So we've got open orgs, I think we're now up to about 40 members from around the planet, who believe that the public should have access to what the public pays for. Pretty simple concept, right? If you paid for something, paid for research to be done, you should be able to read the research. If you paid for textbooks to be produced through a Department of Labor grant, Georgia taxpayers, you pay federal income taxes, you paid for that new national STEM curriculum which is being built in the Northeast Corridor right now. There's a big nursing program being built in Georgia right now. I guarantee you our community colleges in Washington have our eyes on your nursing program. When you're done, we're gonna take it under the terms of the CC BY license and we're gonna update and improve our nursing curriculum in Washington State. So the federal taxpayers of the United States of America paid once for, and we paid a lot, $2 billion, for high-quality educational resources to be created, and then everybody can get access. Is that a better return on investment for the American taxpayer? Yes, the answer is yes. Is it higher impact for the U.S. federal government? You bet. It absolutely is. So we've got a network, and our job and our mission is that if anybody on the planet, any government anywhere, needs help building an open policy, implementing an open policy, convincing a legislature or a parliament or a Congress that an open policy is the right way to go at a national, state, provincial level, we will help. We will write that legislation for you. We will come testify. We'll make sure it gets through, if you're willing to partner with us. We've also just launched something. We're going to meet in a few weeks in San Francisco for the first one called the Institute for Open Leadership. And we've got 14 fellows from 12 countries coming around the world who are leaders in their government, in their institutions, who want to implement open policies but need some help. And so we have the archivist from National Public Radio who's coming in and wants to open up NPR's archives under open licenses. We've got David coming in who said, look, I've got a good start at University of Minnesota. on an open textbook, but I'm really interested in taking it to the next level in my state, in my region, in my institution with open policy. We've got a woman who works in the Ministry of Culture in Greece, because the Greek government is particularly bad at releasing high-res images in 3D of all of the antiquities and museum artifacts that they have in Greece, and she thinks that that's not okay, that the public should have access to these wonderful treasures, and she's looking at a whole digitization project, and then to release all of that under CC licenses and the data under CC Zero. So faculty, here's what you can do. Before you order your textbooks next semester, at least, at a bare minimum, take a look at what else is out there. Right? Before you place that textbook order, take a look at OpenStax. See if they have a book that you're teaching. Go to, there are a variety of open textbook sites. I would highly recommend what University of Minnesota has got. University of British Columbia, just type in British Columbia open textbooks, you'll find their catalog as well. And Minnesota and British Columbia are sharing with each other to update. Do that. Find if you've got an open textbook that meets your needs or that you can revise, you should revise it and use it. And then you should look at how much money you're going to save students, and you should share that with your dean, with your provost, with the chancellor's office. You should tell people, track that. You should find out what OER is out there aside from open textbooks that you can use in your class. Not just, and that's not going to bring any costs down for students. This is about increasing and improving quality. Right? I guarantee you, no offense, but there's more smart people outside of UGA than there are inside UGA. It's a matter of numbers, right? And so get your head up and look around and see what else other people around the world are willing to share. And last but not least, think about what is it that you have that you're particularly proud of, you think is just top notch, that you might want to share that somebody else could benefit from, and put an open license on it. And if you're worried about this, start small. Put just one of your videos out there, one of your papers, one of your, a section of your course. Share small, see what happens, and then start to share bigger after that. College leadership, so deans, chancellor's office, everybody else who's in the room, here's what you can do to support faculty in these efforts. You should look at your strategic plans and find out where open access and where open educational resources fit in. Right? One of those, quite frankly, is promotion and tenure. Faculty respond to the rules and the processes in promotion and tenure. And if your promotion and tenure process discourages them from sharing, which we've actually seen faculty go in and say, I've shared my course, and isn't that wonderful? I helped other people around the world learn, and I've spread the brand of our institution, and others have said, you gotta be nuts, you shouldn't share, we're gonna ding you on that. You gotta make sure that does not happen in your promotion and tenure. You've got to make sure that when faculty are publishing in open access journals, that they're rewarded for that, or at least not penalized because they're getting read 15 times more. They're having a greater impact than they were when they were publishing in closed journals. You should have an open policy on your discretionary monies you're giving out. You've got to support faculty. Faculty, what they mostly need is time, right? Faculty listen to this whole spiel and they say, yeah, that all makes sense, but where do I find the time to do that? Right, so with the Open Course Library, that $1.5 million we spent, it was all to buy out faculty release time. We bought out librarian release time. We bought out instructional designer release time. It's got to be a university-wide conversation. This is not just about faculty administration talking to each other and executing on this. You got to involve student leadership. You've got to involve the library. You've got to involve the bookstore. You want everybody that cares about or is touching content in any way, shape, or form to be involved in this. You should make heroes out of your open leaders. And by that I mean you should give them extra release time, give them more sabbatical time, give them innovation awards, get them in the press, write stories about them, both in your local press and in the student press. Track and report the key performance indicators that you care about. So I just wrote a report for the University System of Hawaii because they said, here's our KPIs, we want to know how open aligns with it. And it's going to, by their estimate, significantly reduce time to degree. It's going to reduce student debt. It's going to allow students to take more courses at the same time. Right? More students will have 100% of the learning resources when they enter. Their learning outcomes are going to go up because they're tracking those at the course level. And for the love of God, if you're doing MOOCs, make sure you put CC licenses on them, because a MOOC that is all rights reserved is not a MOOC, it's a mock. Right, massively open online courses, it's a massively online course if it doesn't have an open license on it. Right, so don't be fooled into that.
Final thought for the 21st century, the opposite of open is no longer closed. The opposite of open is broken, with attribution to my friend John Wilbanks. Thank you very much. Has a question. I'm in trouble.
First of all, I'm a great fan of Creative Commons, and I've licensed some of my stuff. But to use your sort of pizza example, how do we incent people to produce the pizza to begin with? I mean, the authors, the publishers, and so forth. Do you have a particular view on that?
Yeah, I do. We pay them a lot of money. That's my view of it. So with the K-12 OER Collaborative, for example, we're putting out millions of dollars. And we would welcome McGraw-Hill and Wiley and Pearson and everybody else to respond to those RFPs. These states in that particular project are saying, we're going to put into the RFP exactly what we need as consumers, what we want to consume as users, and we're going to write that in, and then we're going to put a lot of money on the RFP. We're going to put it out into the free market, and we'll let the marketplace decide how to respond to that RFP. The difference in business models as opposed to what we did before is we used to, as users in K-12, let somebody else decide what was built. So we all know that textbooks used to be built in K-12 for the Texas, California, and New York State marketplaces, because those are the largest marketplaces. And then Georgia just kind of had to put up with whatever California, Texas, and New York wanted. Well, they don't have to do that anymore. These states are saying, here's exactly what we want. And the difference is that we, the states, are going to keep the copyright, and we're going to put a CC BY license on it. Now, you, the vendors who are replying to this RFP that has tens of millions of dollars on it, if you don't like those terms, that's okay. We'll work with a different vendor. So one of the market risks, which we actually encountered a couple of years ago, because this really happened, New York State got $40 million of Race to the Top money from the U.S. Department of Education. They decided with that $40 million, or part of that $40 million, they wanted to build educational resources for Common Core for New York State. They decided that because this was public money, this was federal money they were getting, even though the feds didn't, although they should have, require an open license on it, New York State said they were going to fix that and put an open license requirement on it. So they put out a CC requirement on the RFP, put millions of dollars on it. The big publishers, including McGraw-Hill, got together and they boycotted the RFP. So somebody who knows the law better than I'm curious if that violated racketeering charges or not. But nevertheless, they boycotted the RFP to send a clear message that no, there is no vendor market for what you're trying to do. We will not participate in that business model, even though there's big money on it. Right? So the RFP was a failure. And everybody said, oh, wait a minute, maybe this doesn't work. Well, we reopened the RFP, or New York Regions reopened the RFP. And then what they did was they dug a little deeper. Right? They looked for new entrepreneurs in the marketplace. These are for-profit companies, but smaller companies. It was Expeditionary Learning and Common Core Inc. and Words and Numbers and these kind of small publishers that are niche publishers that a lot of people have never heard of. But they said, millions of dollars? CC requirement? No problem. We're in. And so when we launched the K-12 OER Collaborative just last week, we had a webinar where any publisher or anybody that wanted to build these resources came. And we didn't have the same problem this time, right? Because that barrier has now been crossed. And the same thing, my answer would be the same if we were talking about higher ed. If UGA decided, or the system decided, so if I had your chancellor's ear here for, the chancellor's office here for over dinner, what I would say to him is, let's look at what the five highest enrolled courses are in the Georgia university system. Let's run that data. And then let's look at OER that's out there. So, oh, good, look, five of them are OpenStax textbooks. Well, those are done. Now let's do 10.
Right, that's been done. Thank you.
How far did you get?
We analyzed the top 50 enrolled courses in the university system.
They're good.
We discovered that there's 1 million enrollments a year in those courses.
How much money are being spent on textbooks?
Lower division courses. At $100 a textbook, that's $100 million a year.
$100 million a year.
And
okay.
We've been working with our colleagues here to map OER, starting with OpenStax.
So perfect. Right. So part of the answer is it might already be done. So that's awesome. You're way ahead of the game.
The other part of the answer is they will at some point find gaps where the market hasn't produced, OpenStax hasn't built the book yet, or somebody else hasn't built the resource. And in that case, what I would say to UGA is it's going to make, because I mean, you look at the numbers they've got, right, the number of enrollments, it makes sense for UGA to go spend $1 million and build a new textbook, right, and then give it away just to UGA students, but also slap a CC BY license on it and give away to the world. And then what UGA really wants to do, or the University of Georgia system, is they really want to come to the next Open Textbooks meeting in British Columbia and join that larger coalition so that they know about everything California is building with their $5 million, right?